So you want to learn how to make red ink. It's quite simple, really. First, you have to make a list. Think of the people you dislike the most. An in-law, a friend from high school perhaps, an ex or two. It doesn't have to be a long list, a handful or so will do. After all, life is short and I have way too much ink in my morgue. I mean studio. After you've selected your source, well, I think you know what to do next. Just kidding. I'm gonna put this back in the kitchen.
Hello everybody. So after making the iron gold black ink that I made in this video, I was immediately excited to try another medieval ink recipe. And of course, the natural progression of life, or at least in my case, is to go with red. Not just because it's my favorite color, but also because it was the second most commonly used ink in manuscripts. Now, I'm not necessarily talking about the illuminations, because there were other colors that were equally used, but more specifically in terms of the actual text. Starting from scratch, when Googling medieval red ink making, I immediately came across this particular manuscript. It is actually a scanned manuscript. Actual text from the 16th century. It is called A Book of Secrets and a very long subtitle. And it was translated to English from the original Dutch in 1596. There is also this modern typed version, which is much easier to read thanks to the Yale University Library. I will link both in the description box if you'd like to find it and actually read the original recipe. The recipe calls for brazil as the main ingredient in the dyeing process, which refers to the more commonly known term Brazil wood. Now, I know what you're thinking. Brazil wood, as in the country Brazil? That place that Europeans didn't really get to until the 16th century? What did people use to make red ink before that? Well, boys and girls and everyone in between, gather around and let me tell you a story about colonization! Once upon a time, in a faraway land, currently referred to as Southeast Asia, textile makers and manuscript painters were happily using their local source for red dye. It was the 2nd century when sapenwood started becoming an integral part of their art, and for 1,000 years, the use of Celsapina sapen continued in this corner of the world. Fast forward to the 12th century, the people of the Western Europe wanted to use it too, surprise, surprise! A sapenwood trade began between the East and the West, which continued for a few more hundred years, until one day in the year 1500, an adventurous, murderous man called Pedro Álvarez Cabral landed in Brazil. Shortly after, a similar tree to the one in Asia was discovered. And as it was the fashion with the contents of this land, the tree was exploited for cheap, unethical sourcing of product, in this case, for what we now call Brazil wood, the Western equivalent of sapenwood. And the trees lived unhappily ever after. The Brazil wood trees in South America are actually still to this day an endangered species. So the first thing I will say in this video is, if you do buy ingredients to make this ink, which I highly encourage you to do, I suggest you order Asian sapenwood, which is what I got. It was pretty easy to find on Etsy. I'm sure there's also other sources to get it. If the only option that you have is from Brazil, make sure it is ethically sourced. So for a little scientific explanation of what makes the red color, the dyeing agent, which is the same on both sources, Asian and Brazilian, is called Brazilin. And this is what reacts to the alkaline components of alum to make the red color. If you would like to do more research in this topic, there are so many names to refer to these trees between their Latin scientific terms and their more commonly known names, so pick your favorite. It'll all lead you to the same Wikipedia article and a few other more trusted sources. So on to the actual ink making. The ingredients that you're going to need for this process are rainwater or vinegar, we'll talk about that in a second, sapanwood, alum, and gum arabic. Now, a fifth ingredient that is optional, but I actually highly recommend it. You'll see what a difference it made in my batch is chalk. This is also a suggestion from the 16th century recipe that I used. So it is all almost historically accurate, other than rainwater actually having way more pollution now than it did 500 years ago, but filter it multiple times. I highly suggest it. So I decided to try both, a rainwater version, in my case snow, because it is Chicago winter. So I gathered snow and let it melt and used it. I actually found that this looks way cleaner than the rainwater looked when I made the black iron gall ink. So I gather a little more just to save it and use it later in when I make the next batch of ink, of black ink. So if all you have is snow, just gather a cleaner patch of it and that works too. So like I said, I wanted to try both bases, one snow batch and one white vinegar batch. So the first thing I did was gather 24 ounces, I think I used, of each one of the base liquids that I'm using, put it in a mason jar, and mixed it with, I think I used 3 grams of the sapanwood for each one. I will correct myself if I'm wrong via editing. I forgot all the measurements already. In terms of the measurements, I actually used as a source a couple blogs that I found that did this ink, and they did it quite successfully. As you may already know, if you do any type of medieval research, they don't love putting very specific measurements, so you just kind of have to play around and figure it out. I did adjust it because they made a bigger batch than I was able to make since I wanted to try both. Both of them only did the vinegar version. And you know what? They have a point. Spoiler alert, the vinegar one turned out better, and that's the one that I will continue making. But I used all the same measurements for both jars of ink. Now, the recipe says to let it sit for 24 hours. I left it way longer, the main reason being that I expected my batch of alum to arrive the next day, and because Chicago likes snowstorms, it got very delayed. So my alum finally arrived about almost a week later, so my sapanwood was soaking in my liquids for about 5 days, I would say, before I finally continued with the process. After these 5 or so days, I continued with the recipe by boiling each one of the mixes until I am left with half of the quantity that I started with. If you have a pot with measurements, that is awesome. I don't have one of those, so you'll see it in the video. I actually used the end of a fork. It's a fork with a design, so I can see the actual difference of how it lowers, and once it reached a middle point, more or less, from the point where I started, I took it out of the heat. Once your quantity is reduced to half, then it is time to add the alum and the gum arabic. I did this while it was still in the pot, and you'll see how awesome it is because it just starts turning red immediately. If you saw my iron gall video, you remember how exciting that was for me. So this time I kind of expected it a little bit because I already have a little bit of experience making ink with medieval processes. But it's still so cool to see. It was really exciting. You just keep moving it and it's red now. Now it's blood. Especially considering it didn't look particularly pretty before I actually put it in the pot. At first, as it was fermenting, it looked kind of disgusting. Again, similar to the other ink, all of these particles swirling around in these liquids are not pretty. I do want to warn you, when you are boiling the vinegar, open some windows, ideally all of the windows that you can possibly open in your kitchen. The smell was really pungent. Like, you can feel it in your eyes, and it became a little hard to breathe. It was intense. I actually finally used my COVID mask inside after still opening my back door and my windows and everything. I kept just walking in and out from the kitchen to take breaks from it. I just highly suggest you do this in a very well ventilated area. If your kitchen doesn't have windows, maybe if you have a portable little stove that you can put outside while doing this, if you choose to do the vinegar version, I highly suggest it. With the rainwater, of course, you have nothing to worry about. It doesn't really smell like much. It's just water. After I mixed in the gum arabic and the alum, I took it out of the pot and I filtered it again. This is the second time I filter it. The first time was filtering the rainwater before actually leaving it to ferment. But I did boil it with all the sediment from the material. So you probably have to do a couple of filterings. I filtered it twice at this point, and there was still some remaining sediment in the jar when I transferred the final version of it. So if you bottle it, for example, which I plan on doing, I highly suggest that you filter it maybe a few more times so that to minimize the amount of sediment in the bottle. And so, moment of truth, this is what the ink looks like. This one is the snow version, this one is the vinegar version. You'll notice they have different undertones. When I do this, it becomes more obvious. This one is more of an orangey vermilion red. This one has way more of a cool tone leaning towards wine red, which is really the first visual difference that you can notice between the snow and the vinegar. Before this, really the only difference was the smell. Of course, the vinegar one smells like vinegar. Now, once I tried them, I'm not gonna lie, I was disappointed. I did not like the shades of red that were happening with this ink. It was actually looking more purpley, which wouldn't bother me really if it was a more intense purple, but it just wasn't. The first time I tried it was in Rhodia paper. And then I decided to try it in this plasticky vellum, modern vellum paper that I have, and that was a disaster. That was even worse. Actually, I can show you that one right here. It was not very pretty. Put this in front of my face so that I can... Yeah, it just looks watered down mess. But then I tried it in watercolor paper, hot pressed to be more specific so that I have a smoother surface to work with, and that one actually started working out better. I noticed that when the ink was very puddled in a specific area, it was gorgeous, so I was thinking, okay, it has potential. It still didn't look consistently good, at least not for what I was hoping for. I did decide to play with a puddle. You'll see my little blood stain that I wanted to play with. But that's when I decided to try the option that the recipe gives you, which is adding chalk. I didn't go for traditional school chalk because I figured that probably has some added components in order to have it, you know, stay in a stick for the convenience of teachers writing. So I looked for pure chalk and I landed on Amazon in the world of edible chalk. That's a thing. I didn't know this was a thing. If you like eating chalk, please tell me. I am absolutely fascinated by this now. When you read the reviews on edible chalk on Amazon, it's all talking about the taste and the best way to prepare it in order to eat it. I had a good time reading those comments. But anyway, if you eat chalk, let me know, what's the appeal of it? I have to admit, I didn't try it. I was going to try it, and then it's like, I'm not sure about this. Maybe I'll try it one of these days when I'm feeling extra brave. Maybe right before I go to the dentist. You can also find on Etsy chalk, pure chalk, made specifically for dyeing purposes, which I did find and I did buy it. It did take a little longer to arrive, so I didn't end up using it because I got a little impatient, obviously. But I already have it now for future use. The next time I make this red ink, I'm probably going to use the one from Etsy. So I took turns adding chalk or more gum arabic in the mixtures. The thought behind adding more gum arabic is because the water, the rainwater original recipe, calls for cherry tree sap, which of course I can't really get, but I figured, okay, that's some sort of type of glue, and the whole purpose of gum arabic is acting as the binder, so I figured maybe as a substitute for cherry tree sap, I can use a little more additional gum arabic. So in order to play with my two batches, I first added gum arabic to the snow jar, and then I added the chalk to the vinegar jar to see what difference it makes. And it already made such a huge difference. I was testing it both on Rhodia paper and in watercolor paper. The watercolor paper looks much better, I have to admit. I don't think I'll be using this ink much in my Rhodia journal, but I definitely want to use it for manuscript style artworks, which usually happen in other types of paper anyway. So I can definitely use the watercolor paper when I want to use this ink. Although it had gotten much better with these additions, I wanted to push it further and see what else I can get. So then I alternated it, then I added the chalk to the snow version, and I added more gum arabic to the vinegar version. Funnily enough, the snow version got worse. It actually looked much better before I added the chalk. So if you want to stick with making the snow version, rainwater version, whether it is because of the vinegar smell, maybe if you don't like that, the rainwater version would be a better option for you. Or simply because it is a free source, vinegar isn't, so you might as well make that if that's what you have accessible. I recommend adding more gum arabic. Basically, I doubled the amount of gum arabic, but I don't recommend adding chalk. Maybe skip it because it didn't really turn out very nicely. It actually did the opposite of what I thought it was going to do and watered it down somehow. However, the vinegar became gorgeous, and this is the you're gonna see this in the close-ups of me writing with this inks, but the vinegar turned out absolutely beautiful. It still looks a little purpley, definitely looks in more in the cooler side of the red spectrum, but I love the color. It is rich, it is what I was hoping for. It feathers a little bit in the Rhodia paper, but not as much as it did before I added the additional gum arabic, which makes sense because gum arabic binds it more, adds more consistency, so then it should feather less. And if you notice, the areas where it feathered was in the edges of the paper, which is where inks tend to feather more because we tend to put our hand there, so the oils of your hand affect the consistency, the texture of the paper, making it feather it a bit more. But in the middle of the page where my hand hasn't really been placed, I tried to use a napkin in between so that I tried to avoid oils going into the paper. It did not feather once I added the additional ingredients. So this is definitely the version I will continue making. And yes, just like with the Iron Gall ink, I am selling bottles of this red ink as well. They will come in the same bottles, which have a dropper cap. They work really well. I'm still using them for the Iron Gall ink, and they are fantastic. I don't really have any complaints about these bottles. I think they're a good size. They're not tiny, they're not ginormous, and the dropper is great because you can easily transfer it into an inkwell. I finally, decided to open my Etsy shop. It took a little bit forever. If you follow me on Instagram, you know I've been talking about this for months now, but I seem to do that all the time. I just talk about something for months and then eventually it actually happens. I will put the link in the description below for my new Etsy shop. Right now, all that's there is bottles of black Iron Gall ink and the red sapanwood vinegar ink. There should also be, by this point, an original piece of manuscript art, and then I am planning on making prints for that as well. Maybe I'll have them by the time this video goes up. If I do, it will be there too. If not, it is coming very shortly, so you can wait for that. Anyway, this is it for this video. This was such a fun process, a long process, but a really fun process of experimenting and trying things out, and exactly what I picture people in medieval times doing, just figuring out recipes in terms of what works best and then forgetting to give us the actual measurements. Let me know if you make this ink. I would love to see how yours turns out. It was so much fun when I did the Iron Gall ink. Some of you guys tagged me in your recreations of the ink, and it makes me really happy to see that you guys are getting creatively engaged with me in these processes. But that's it for now. I will see you soon with another video, and have a fantastic day. Bye.